Dear friends, let us stand and face the entrance of the church where we will greet the body of Julia, where her body will enter the church for the last time. Now I invite you to be seated for a moment for a eulogy.
My brother Carlos has written this beautiful eulogy for our mother, His message is focused from his own perspectives and experiences with mom. However, my brother Miguel and I share with him the memories, feelings, and thoughts. I always saw mom as a strong woman of principles who believed in herself, in her own honesty, her own strength, her work, her creativity, but above all, her Catholic faith in Jesus and his teachings. She was a woman who enjoyed experimenting with her fashion creations. She enjoyed discovering how it would be for her, creating new models, new place in the market for her, and was a fun and entertaining exploration, even if she didn't care if she would sell her designs or not. But she always did. After being a nurse, executive secretary, and bank accountant, accompanied by Francisco, her life partner, she entered the world of business and doing what she was passionate about, using her creativity for the world of fashion and dance. Together, they formed a company closely with our father, in part because what I mentioned before, she had to face the challenges many women face when collecting debts from defaulters or when encountering aggressive drivers in Lima's traffic. She had to face different challenges. The first of these was the experience of being torn between being a mother and a businesswoman, being a friend to her children and or companion to her husband, maintaining harmony in the family and maintaining order at home. I don't know how she did it, but mom always found the perfect balance between work and home. Her life and satisfaction was to help the poorest and most needy. She was an expert listener, looking for solutions or trying to alleviate the emotional pain of those who were struggling with problems. Her love, patience, and kindness were infused in everything she taught me. She taught me to write my first letters, to write my first sentences, long before I go into school. And mom had so much patience to teach and gave me so much self-confidence that when I first went to school, I still remember the teachers couldn't believe it. They were thinking that it was impossible that I could have done those tasks at my age, and they thought it had been done by my sister Mary. I will highlight patience, love, and confidence as her best qualities. Patience and confidence to teach me to drive at the age of 14. She taught me how to operate industrial knitting machines when I was only 15. And with the same patience, 3 months ago, she taught Carmen, my wife, how to knit a crochet. Mom Julia had that unnerving point of balance that instilled control with a calm look around her even when there were dangers. She was the kind of person who kept her cool in all sorts of weird and bizarre situations. Like when in the middle of a devastating earthquake in 1970 in Peru, while the neighbors ran out into the streets, she carefully and calmly returned to the house to seek a blanket for our little sister Lizzie, who was only a baby, so she couldn't get a cold. Always her displays of patience and love for her children, such as the one she had with our sister Mary, who often didn't want to eat, and mom, despite being in a hurry with time to attend to her business, had the patience to make sure that Mary at 11 are enough for feeding her in the mouth, playing the little train and the little plane trick. Or when another occasion, mom was teaching dad how to drive at our manual transmission car engine. Stop as a result of stalling when dad was driving slowly over bumps caused by the train's tracks while the train was coming. His shaking hands couldn't start the car. We all screamed inside the car, and Mom, with a calm voice, repeated, "Don't be afraid, breathe and calm down. Try again, I'm sure you can." Managing to calm him down, I made him start the car, and we ran out of that place. Being with her children was what Julia enjoyed most of all. She joined in different ways. Memorable times we spent together with her. The songs of the three little piggies, the song of the little chicks are squeaking before going to sleep, or listening together to Aunt Natasha radio program at 6 o'clock in the afternoon, or on Sundays when we share Chinese snacks or sweets after church. Beautiful time with Mom and the family going to Chosica, Wampani, Barba Blanca, or our trips to Cajamarca and Chiclayo. Our friendly conversations before going to sleep, and only 3 months ago, our almost daily chats at lunchtime by video conference, showing her love for her family, keeping her faith in God through all her life. This is a wonderful legacy. This is a wonderful example to follow. Right now, Mom, that you completed your cycle in this life, I imagine myself floating up and moving back in time, back to your womb, back to before my very first memory. Maybe to that moment when I was just a cell, getting ready to embark on a great adventure and flowing into the one little cell with all of the knowledge, all the wisdom, all the understandings that I have today and merge into that cell and teach that little cell everything you taught me all these years, everything it's ever going to need to know, everything it's ever going to need to feel, to believe, to experience, to understand, to know what I know intuitively as that cell multiplies inside of you, Mom. Feels breathing the gold bright color that you, Mom, once recorded in your mind on your childhood when you got your first award at the school and all your feelings that you passed to me. In this life, through that little Paquito baby cell, I am realizing what happens, especially the one that connected to your beautiful voice, that one song. One sang tangos or sang from movies for Libertad Lamarque or Carlos Gardel. The vibration of the melody of your voice that you sang while you were working in your fashion business with an energy that inoculated, immunized, strengthened when you gave me the understanding I didn't have in that other life inside your womb. And when I knew, I got that. I went on a little journey feeling the transformations in my body multiplying, amplifying, building up the reservoir, that stockpile, that unimaginable infinite ability to choose, to change, to understand differently now and when I became fully formed within you. At some point, comes the moment where it was time for me to enter a brave new world. In that moment of your pain and my pain of birth, and I passed through that event, bringing all of this with me through that first day, and your voice, Mom, was there for comfort again, explaining to me, helping me to understand and see the world properly. After that, each every day, your voice grew stronger, more soothing, more comforting, more empowering, more liberating, because I realized I was on an adventure, and between, and whenever I went and whatever I did, your voice was with me through the days, the weeks, the months, growing stronger, and the feeling got stronger. Your voice rose louder year after year, but every moment of every day, your voice taught me, explained me things, and I notice how I move through years and decades of my life with your voice guiding me, telling me what to do, telling me what's coming and how to get it better. Making it better, and maybe every now and then with this voice of you, ma'am, by my side, inside and out, listening and teaching me. I stop, I turn around, I look back, and I look at the amazing life you, ma'am, had led me. Because your voice was there for me to guide me and love me, 1,000% to teach me all the things I needed to know in that moment. A voice of absolute trust, a voice that loves me, a voice that wanted only the very best thing for me. Your voice, ma'am, a voice of strength, of comfort, of protection, of wisdom, of understanding, a voice that gave me really good advice, and your beautiful voice was a voice of love that will always be with me, minding me, telling me, teaching me things, telling me the best perspectives to take on any situation, our circumstance that I encounter as I listen to your voice in my mind. Now I know when I was growing up, you were that special friend to teach me, to mentor me, to show me things that were really true, who gave me the best advice with no agenda other than love, to help me to become the very best version I could myself be. And after going through certain understandings and certain experiences, I know how I now have your voice, like a voice of absolute trust, patience, love, peace, serenity, and protection. I became aware how the quality and the richness of your voice growing remind me that I must always be aware of that no matter where I go, no matter what I do, no matter what life has me, no matter what who comes into my life or who goes out, that some people do good things and sometimes not so good things. Your voice will remind me, keep myself safe, remind me of all the very best things about me in a voice that I can always trust, a voice that I can always believe, a voice that speaks 10 times louder than any other voice, that draws out every other voice. Your wonderful voice, ma'am, will go with me, reminding me that I'm always loved, protected, accepted, forgiven for all wrong, real, or imagined, and I'll never, ever, ever be alone. And now that you are not anymore in this life, in this space, to listen, to understand, I let your voice to take root deep inside me in every cell, reminding me I'm here. You got this. You are always good enough, empowering, feeding me, telling me all the things I most needed to hear. But I needed to hear in those critical moments that would have made all a difference and grow. Now I have your voice telling me no matter where you go, no matter what you do, no matter what life hands you, your voice says I will always be here for you. To hold your hand when there is nobody else to hold your hand, to give you that hug that you need when you need it, to remind you of all every best things about you in a voice that you can always trust, a voice that you can always believe, a voice that speaks 10 times louder than any other voice that drowns out every other voice. Now that you are not here, ma'am, when I stop and listen inside me, I will hear your voice telling me all those important things, the best perspective to take, how to approach things, avoid that, go, do that, go for it, you deserve it. You own this. You are always good enough. When I was with you, Mother, in the last few days of your life, I spent with you, and in that last moments, when you held my hand, I give you that hug back to remind you of all the very best things about you as a mother, as a wife, as a sister, as a daughter, as a human being, reminding you that you are always you are always will be with me for the rest of my life. I love you, Mom. I'm now just gonna read a couple of letters from my other brother for the families that are right now listening and seeing us from different parts of the world. Para los familiares y amigos en el Perú y en otras partes del mundo que nos acompañan con sus oraciones y pensamientos en estos momentos en que celebramos el retorno de mi mamá Julia al seno de la vida, les damos gracias por su presencia y queremos que sepan que para mi mamá ustedes siempre fueron parte de su corazón y su vida. Mi familia y yo les damos gracias y pedimos al Señor que siempre los tenga en su corazón. Gracias. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mary. Please stand. Let us pray. O God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant, Julia, whom you have called to journey to you. And since she hoped and believed in you, grant that she may be led to our true homeland, to delight in its everlasting joy. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings from the Scriptures.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it or the cry of distress. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons and daughters of God, for you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption to sonship. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay, and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly, while we wait for adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. The word of the Lord.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Miguel and Mary, and I think Carlos, who might be watching in Australia, and all of Julia's family and friends, on behalf of all the parishioners here of Holy Name of Jesus Parish, I offer you my deepest condolences. Please be assured of my prayers, of our prayers for you, and especially for your mother, Julia. Now, as Christians, when all seems lost, we know it's not. When everyone says or acts as if all there is this world, this is the end of it all, we know there's more. When it seems like everybody's against us, like no one's there for us, the people are opposed to us at every step, we know that there is one who is always with us, who loves us tremendously, who's never against us. And that, of course, we know is God. It's Jesus Christ. He's with us at every step. He's our hope. He's our salvation. He's the reason we're here today in this church right now. He's the one who's conquered death so that death will not have the last say. And so although today is a time of sadness, it is. It's also a time, I believe, and it's my job to say it, a time of great hope. It's a time of joy. Joy of knowing that this isn't the end, that there is so much more waiting for us. That's the joy. There's a beautiful story of St. Francis of Assisi. He was in the woods, walking in the woods with good Brother Juniper. And Brother Juniper said to him, "Francis, Brother Francis, look at the birds in the air, the animals in the grass, and the fish in the brook. They're so happy. But we, men and women, we're not as happy as they are. Why? Why are we not as happy as they?" And St. Francis, he said to Brother Juniper, "Good Brother Juniper, it's like this. The fish in the brook, the animals in the grass, and the birds in the air, they're made for this world. That's why they're so happy. But we men and women, we're not made for this world. That's why we can never be fully happy here." And it's true. We're made for something better. We're made for something greater. And if you look around, yeah, we're not totally happy here. I'm not saying we don't have moments of joy and happiness. But there's also moments of incredible suffering and sorrow. And we're here today at a funeral. Or if we look at the life of Julia, I've heard she had many beautiful moments, but we can't deny that I'm sure she had trials of many sorts. A few that I've heard that come to mind are the trials of losing people. So for example, her husband of many years, Francisco, or her daughter, I heard, who passed away last year, Elizabeth. These are forms of suffering for her and for you and for us. And so we know that there's got to be more. This can't be it. But even in her trials, even in her sufferings, she was still loved and is still loved by all of you, her family, but especially, most importantly, by our Heavenly Father, God. And this applies to us too right now. Being here right now, it's not easy. I'm sure we're experiencing internal grief, suffering, pain, and in that sense, this loss is a true cross. Any loss is. It's a cross. It's a form of suffering. But the important thing to remember is that the Lord is with us, and he suffered it first. He died first. And he did that so that we wouldn't be alone in our suffering, and so that all of our suffering and sorrow will not be just be meaningless, as if it amounts to nothing. If we unite it with him on the cross, it amounts to something great. And so my suggestion, very practical suggestion for each of us here today, is to unite whatever suffering we might be feeling to that of Jesus's pain. For an intention. A beautiful intention today will be for the soul of Julia. Now, I don't just want to focus on the negative things, the suffering. I think we also need to thank God for the joys that we've experienced in this life through and with Julia. And so today is a day to give thanks also. I want to just highlight a few things which I think we can be grateful for that I learned, just a few little tidbits that I learned from Mary in talking about her mother. So one thing which stands out in my mind from what I heard was Julia's dedication. Her dedication first and foremost to her family, to you. She was dedicated, I was told, even to her own siblings at a very early age, because she lost her mother when she was 10. So maybe in a sense she was a bit of a mother to even her siblings. But nonetheless, she was there and helping them. And then after her marriage, she of course had her own children, and I'm told she completely dedicated to them. After work, for example, she would devote time to each child, to be with each one, to hear each one, to talk with each one, as if each one was just the only child, I'm sure. And then she was also devoted to her husband, Francisco, for many years. I believe he was almost 101 when he passed away. It's a long time. But they were married for many years, and I'm sure it was not easy at the end, as old age creeps up on us, things happen, but she was there to help him totally. And it didn't even stop at that with her own family. Her dedication extended beyond her family. And so she helped the elderly in a care home. I think it was Langley Lodge. And I should add, this is a personal note, Langley Lodge is where my grandmother was before she passed away. And so there's a connection there, I see. And so for anybody that goes to help the elderly, as she did, that's beautiful. It's a sign of her love. And now taking it further, I firmly believe, as I heard in the eulogy and from you, that she was completely devoted to God. Her faith was precious. And this really is half the point of our faith. It gives us courage and joy in serving others as well. Because in serving others and being devoted to family and friends and those beyond that, that is really a form of serving Jesus Christ. And so we saw that in her devotion to the Blessed Mother, in her going to church so often and raising all of you in the faith, something which is so precious. And I say this is the most precious thing, not just because I'm a priest, I'm supposed to say it. I firmly believe it because I am a priest, because I believe it is the most precious thing, our faith, because it's the one thing that we take with us to the end. It's the one thing, in a certain sense, which gets us to the end, to be with Jesus, to be with each other forever. And so for all of these things, plus I know there's many, many more, I did not know Julia personally. You did. And so you, I'm sure, could think of many things that you could be grateful for her life. The very fact that you exist is another big one. But we pray that she is home with the one who she loved the most and who loved her the most. And you might say, I'm talking about Francisco. I'm sure that's up there, but I'm talking about God. God who loved her the most. And which brings me to one of my favorite little stories, and I'll conclude with this. There was a missionary who had served overseas for over 40 years. And near the end of that time, his health was waning, so he decided to return home to the United States of America. And he was returning home on the same ocean liner as the President of the United States, by coincidence. And as they got near to the dock in New York, there was a huge commotion, a huge hubbub of people waiting to greet the President of the United States. And when this missionary saw all those people, he thought to himself, there's no one here to greet me. So he became a little jealous. And in a moment of despair, he cried out to God. He said, Lord, I've given you my life as a missionary, and now not a soul welcomes me home. And our Heavenly Father responded, my dear child, you're not home yet. We pray that Julia is now truly home with her Heavenly Father, and that one day we may be there with her and our Heavenly Father too. Please stand. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his. We now have a series of intercessions, and the appropriate response for each intention is, hear our prayer. Hear our prayer. In baptism, Julia received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead her over the waters of death. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Our sister Julia was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome her into the halls of the heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Many friends and members of our families have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy. Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer unjustly these sins against your love, and gather them to the eternal kingdom of peace. Lord, in your mercy. Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. Lord, in your mercy. The family and friends of Julia seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. Lord, in your mercy. We are assembled in the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom. Through Christ our Lord. Please be seated now for the offertory. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you, Lord, these sacrificial offerings for the salvation of your servant, Julia, we beseech your mercy that she who did not doubt her son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
Our God.
In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Please kneel or be seated. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Julia, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your
spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. This time we have Holy Communion, which we believe and know is truly the body and blood of Jesus Christ. It's wonderful to have you all here. I'm not sure if there are people of different faiths. Regardless, everybody's welcome. But we do ask that only practicing Catholics receive Holy Communion. So if you are not a Catholic, or are a Catholic but haven't been practicing your faith, or simply not spiritually ready at this time, I invite you instead to come forward and you can receive a blessing, and you may indicate that by placing your arm across your heart, like so. Or if you prefer, you may remain seated in your pews.
Please stand.
Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Julia may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Just before our final commendation, on behalf of the family, I'd like to thank all of you so much for being here, for celebrating this liturgy with us, for praying for Julia, and for the consolation for the family. And I think we'll be going to the cemetery. We have a cemetery service at 1 o'clock, Gardens of Gethsemane in Surrey.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. And now invite you in a moment of silence to pray for you. In baptism, Julia shared in the death and resurrection of Christ. May she be welcomed into the glory of eternal life. I now sprinkle her body with holy water, which once again is a reminder of the water poured upon her on the day of her baptism. As a sign of respect for our sister Julia, we let this incense rise to God, who has called her to share in his glory. Of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. Amen. Dear friends, may every mark of affection and every gesture of friendship that you give to others be a sign of God's peace for you. In peace, let us take our sister to her place of rest. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
What do they come from the heart?